Ladies and gentlemen, nerds and neckbeards.
Nerds and neckbeards.
Welcome to the 23rd edition of...
23rd episode.
Westeros Whenever-ly.
Whenever-ly.
This episode is all about Jaime Lannister.
That stumphand himself. And the ways I think that he differs from the show Jaime, which are really important, but just, he's awesome. So he's worth having a little... A little conversation about.
Tana, why don't you tell our listeners what we're drinking?
Ah, so tonight, in the spirit of Jaime's quest across these books of moving from soiled knight status to honorable knight status or true knight status, I thought, wouldn't it be fun if we drank Black Knights? I can't remember what I called them on the website. But they're like soiled
knights.
Because
we did three shots already, Tana.
Because we're doing. So it's like it's a Black Russian essentially. Okay. So it's coffee liqueur. Kahlua.
Not excited for this.
It's Kahlua liqueur. Kahlua, which is coffee liqueur, and vodka. We're using a vanilla vodka together, shaken over ice, and poured into a rocks glass over a lot of ice. And then we filled up our Westeros Whenever-ly tumbler. That noise you hear is Dave eating spicy beef jerky?
Yeah.
So you're gonna do a milk-based drink and spicy beef jerky all night?
Well, I mean, I gotta...
Whatever floats your boat,
I gotta
man.
Somehow get rid of this coffee flavor, which I'm really scared
so
of.
So you're gonna use the beef jerky as a stirrer? Okay, I'm not judging. This is a judgment-free zone, Dave.
I'm really scared for this drink. You don't even understand.
So
I hate coffee.
Our longtime listeners will know that you are against Kahlua specifically. I tried to do House of Black and White shots way, way, way back when we first started our podcast, and you were not having it at all. You were like, I don't drink coffee. I don't like coffee. I won't drink anything coffee-flavored.
No.
Blah, blah, blah.
And you're forcing me to drink this.
Well, I figured so. As we go along, so as we drink down the Black Russian or the Black Knight, we'll refill it from the White Russian
as
tumbler.
We put the Black Knight in our mouth.
That's right. So
we
got to process it. That's right.
Whole in our mouth.
That's right. Well, we have to like process our own Dark Knight status because inside every person, Dave, is light and dark.
Wow,
and
Tana.
So we're just sort of emulating that with our drinks this evening.
That was real deep, Tana.
Right?
Real deep.
And so that's the idea. As we drink our drinks, they'll become lighter and whiter and move closer, like Jaime Lannister, toward true knight status.
Okay, so should we taste these?
Yeah, so here we go, dude.
I'm so scared. You don't even know.
Yours is... It already looks like a White Russian. But okay, here we go. Ready? Mine is very dark. Here we go.
All men.
Must drink. Yeah, man, that's a good drink. That is just, that's a fine on the rocks. It's rich, coffee, ice cold.
I'm glad I don't taste the coffee as much.
Yeah?
Because I think I can drink that.
Yeah?
Yeah.
So it's not nearly as bad as you were making it out to be.
I you know what? I was way afraid for no reason.
Have you decided what your house words are going to be?
No.
Yeah.
I think it's, I hate coffee.
I hate coffee.
It's gonna be my house words.
What is your Yeti cooler of ice? Water.
Water. That should be my sigil. Screw
just
what we discuss later.
A
just a Yeti with ice water flowing over. And,
you'll be like a water maiden.
Yeah. And it'll just be like H2O in the background. And it's just like, I hate coffee. And my words.
Kirsten and I have our family words. Our house words are... Don't be a butt.
Don't be a butt. Yeah. That's...
And so I feel like those are words anybody can live by. You know, just like, don't be a butt. Just everybody, don't be a butt. They're just, it's a good word to have.
I have a mumble server for when I play games. And
okay.
My one and only rule is don't be a fuckboy.
Don't be a fuckboy?
Yeah.
Oh, God.
So, maybe those should be your house words.
I have deep roots in the queer community. I don't think being a fuckboy is necessarily a bad thing.
Well, I mean, in the Urban Dictionary sense of a fuckboy,
I don't know.
Like, you know, just a boy who fucks around.
Yeah.
You know, that, I mean,
I don't want to know the Urban Dictionary thing of it.
Yeah,
but this is the idea. What was our shot tonight? You came up with
the shot. Our shot was a cinnamon sword crunch shot.
You surprised me with this. You were just like, I know what we're having.
I know we're doing it. We're doing it. It's equal parts rum chata
and
a cinnamon whiskey. We had Jack Daniel's cinnamon whiskey.
I have never had the Jack Daniel's cinnamon whiskey before, and how delighted was I that it wasn't Fireball.
It's much, much better than Fireball.
Yeah, it is. It was delicious. Yes, I was like, oh God, frat boy party, we're going to have Fireball. But it wasn't. It was Jack Daniel's jumping on the cinnamon whiskey train.
Yeah, it was good. It was absolutely good. Yeah. So, anyway, so that's what we did our shot.
And I think we're ready to get down and dirty with Jamie.
I think, well, should we do a recap of the season two, season six, episode two first? Just a quick recap.
All right. Lead us off.
So, most of you have watched, they jumped right in and said, fuck you to everyone who said, you're going to draw it out. And, the very end of the episode, they resurrected Jon Snow.
They sure did.
Now, I think my favorite part of that episode was Davos.
Yeah.
First off,
this was his big line.
It was his big line. It
Apologies for what you were about to see.
That was such a disappointment because I thought we were going to see Davos kick some serious ass.
Surrounded by enemies. Yeah. It looked in the trailer like he was surrounded by enemies, and I was like, oh great, he's actually surrounded by friends. That was a good sort of whoever's stitching together their promo materials is doing a great job.
Their editor for their trailer totally made it seem like it was completely different. Yep. And so
that takes work, man. If you're going to just... The way they intercut... I was blown away by that first trailer that came out, the I Choose Violence.
Right.
Like, that thing knocked me off my feet. That trailer is why I'm watching this season, you know? And I like that that the twists are coming through. Like, I thought that Davos was going to be in a room full of enemies.
Yep.
Apologies for what you're about to see. And he unsheathes Longclaw.
And he fights them, yeah.
Yeah, and he's outnumbered 7-1 or something.
Yeah.
But I also like that he's in a room with friends, you know, and he actually stands a chance.
And then the fucking wildlings bust through the door.
Yeah.
And what I think was a little ridiculous is that the Castle Black Night's Watch basically just give up. They're like,
I was hoping that that One Wag 1.1 would smash the guy against the wall a bunch of times, because that scene at the end of the books, which is what this is sort of mashed up, is 1-1 is smashing Sir Patrick of King's Mountain, who's a complete, like, rapist sicko, and he was just, like, a total creep. And he ends up getting bashed, his head gets bashed against the wall like a dozen times. And it's awesome, because 1-1 is just like talking about the visuals of that giant were awesome. I haven't seen a giant yet.
Yeah. Oh, well,
the show is doing some good stuff,
guys. You need to watch.
That giant was awesome.
You missed 50 hours worth of awesomeness.
I happily missed it.
You missed 50 hours worth of awesomeness.
They got the kinks out, the bugs out. The dragons were awesome. The CGI dragons looked very cool.
Okay, so there were two Tyrion lines that I know of off the top of my head that are easily going to be t-shirts.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, one is...
That's
what I do. I drink and I know things.
Perfect line.
And it fits our podcast.
Oh, yeah.
With the exception of knowing things.
Yeah, that should be... Well, yeah, we have to modify it. That's what we do. We drink and don't know things.
And don't know things. There you go. There you go.
Westeros whenever
they... Hashtag all men must drink. Oh, man. And the other one was, he's saying the bars right after he, like, frees the dragons. And he's like, if I ever have an idea like that again, punch me in my face.
That one was a little too on the nose for me. I knew it would play well with the audience. Like, I thought I could feel, like, the nerd kingdom just sort of, like, getting very happy about that when I saw it. But for me, it was just a little bit too much. Also... Whatever, we don't have to break apart the real differences between the show and the book, but one of the big ones is that the dragons are not intelligent. Georgia said they have, if anything, an alien intelligence, but they don't, like, understand who Tyrion is and that he's a friend. They don't understand language.
Well, so. I mean, they could probably... I mean, if we abide by the very well-ly established theory that he's a Targaryen...
Yeah.
Then, I mean, they could maybe sense that, so...
There was the scene when Quentin goes to free the dragons in Dance of Dragons, and he's there with Pretty Maris.
Mm-hmm.
She's the only girl there. She's from the Windblown, and some of the Windblown are in there, like, getting, I don't know, the mutton ready or whatever they're trying to do, And the dragons are, like, sniffing her out and looking at her and paying attention to her.
Like, are you mother?
Yeah. And
are you
mother? Quentin's like, oh my god, they realize that she's a female. They're wondering if she's Daenerys. They're wondering if she's familiar. And so they were, like, not being gentle, but they were paying attention to her and, like, focused on the female in the room. Which, you know, so George is like, I don't know, there's a sort of intelligence there, but it's not like they understand the language and sentences and I'm your friend. And
it's not like the dragon in Merlin where John Hunt is the voice of the dragon and he just comes out and just
I don't
like,
know that.
Hello, Merlin.
I don't know that.
Obscure BBC reference there. Sure. But that's okay. There's nothing wrong with BBC
nothing
America.
Wrong at
anyway.
All. My brother did tell me a thing. He was like, Tana, did you watch all the way to the end of the episode? And we were texting, and I said, yeah, why? And he goes, well, I have a funny story for you. Okay, what is it? He goes, at the end of the episode, I just get a text message from one of his best friends, a guy named Matt, and Matt texts him and just says, resurrection boner. And that's, like, the only thing that the text says. And so Pat goes on with his night, like, does the dishes, whatever. He's going to bed that night. And
all of a sudden,
he just starts laughing. He just starts laughing. And Jesse turns over, his wife turns over and is like, what are you laughing at? Like, there was no sound or anything. And he's like, I just thought of something funny. And the next morning, he texts his friend Matt. And he was like, it's not a resurrection boner. It's a resurrection erection. And Matt was like, I'm glad you woke up thinking about my boner for singing to me.
Yes, yes.
And Pat was like, actually, it was the last thing I thought of last night. So peek behind the curtain of my family.
I like your family just by the stories I hear. Oh, man.
So, yeah, very exciting. He's awake.
He's awake.
He's awake. Spoilers.
And I think one of the greatest parts about that episode was, so Davos is like, you know, he doesn't believe in anything, right?
Yeah. This is silly to me. You can talk about it, but this is one of the sillier moments of the show for
well,
me.
Well, he makes the comment, like, he goes to her and he's like, fuck it, Red R'hllor, the drowned god, the old god, the new guys. Who gives a fuck? He's basically like, who gives a fuck?
It's all the same.
I've seen you birth a fucking drag, you know, a shadow demon out of your vagina.
Right.
Get your ass in there and work some fucking magic.
Right.
And the best part, I think, is that she goes in there and it fails a couple times. Yeah. I don't know if it fails a couple times, but it takes a little while to enact. And I like the scene where she walks away. It's the very last scene, right before he wakes up.
First,
she
the
walks
wildlings
away.
Leave.
First,
then
well,
leaves,
yeah,
then
Thorin.
Or she leaves and then Davos.
Tormund Giantsbane is like, "Fuck this!" Hits the wall and walks out. You know, then it's like a couple the other White Night's Watchmen, and then she leaves, and Davos just kind of lingers over the body for a second, and I'm thinking, oh shit, is Davos gonna try now? Is Davos gonna put his hands on there and just start onion nights? Onion night. And I got
John was a Ouija board.
John was a Ouija board, right? I was so excited for that. And
it perpetually smells like onions after
that. Yeah, right. You see ghosts going. That's what wakes ghosts up. This is like, what onions? What is this? And all of a sudden, John wakes up from dead.
It
but
all
okay.
Makes
sense.
It all makes sense.
So, and we see a Bran flashback
to
Lyanna Stark.
Oh, that was very cool. That's very cool.
Definitely, 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 you can see them planting the seeds for R plus L equals J.
Lyanna's a really good horse person, horse woman. Horseman.
She's known as an excellent horse rider, and where do we see her? She's riding in on a horse, and she's, you know, this, you know, beautiful young girl who just rides on a horse and hops off. And
couple things. They call the three-eyed crow the three-eyed raven, which is fine. I recognize that actor from something, but I can't place him. And then also, he's got two eyes and no blood raven birthmark.
I was thinking that, like where's the birthmark?
But okay, all right, okay.
I mean, I guess
he's also up and walking around. So this show is the show.
Well,
that's
he's up
say.
And walking around,
like in the
vision. In his visions.
Right.
But so is Bran.
Right,
so
right,
I mean,
right.
That's not that big of a stretch to me because
fair point.
But yeah, when you see him like wrapped up in the tree, I didn't see any wine stain. birthmark on his face, which may just be that takes 4 hours of fucking makeup to do every time we want to show
let's
him.
Let's just put him in a raven cloak.
Let's put him in a raven cloak.
Call it done.
Exactly. Yeah. So let's
save our budget for those dragons.
Right. Exactly. So well, their budget is I'm sure endless at this point because they've got.
You would think
they're like the second biggest show on TV.
You would think.
You know
what's the biggest show?
So The Walking Dead.
Oh, is it?
No, yeah, absolutely.
It's bigger than HBO's Game of
well,
Thrones.
Well, I mean, you have to also think about it this way. HBO Game of Thrones is on a premium network.
Oh, yeah, that's true. That's
so
true.
Not everyone in America has access to it, whereas The Walking Dead is on AMC, and it's free, yep. Basically, if you have cable.
I stopped watching Walking Dead. I can only watch it in the middle of the day when the lights, like, when it is super bright out, because I have nightmares. I will have nightmares forever.
Aww.
And
aww,
I owe
Tana.
It to myself to not be such a chicken. And also, I have the mute button ready, because my friend Murph told me that he was, like, a film major. And he goes, Tana, if you're ever afraid of a movie, just put it on mute.
Yeah, it's
because
true.
If you watch the movie, it's fine. But it's all
it's
that,
the
like,
music
it's the build
and ambiance.
And that, like, screechy and the, like, you can now.
Sound
now
design
movies,
is
like, the,
very, very, like, lucrative.
There's always heartbeats.
And, yeah, we'd
there,
have, like, 1,000 more listeners if we had some sound design in the back.
I think our
and
sound
was
effects
would
be doodly doo. Doodly doo. Doodly doo. Let me just keep playing some clips from my phone.
Yeah. All right. So are there any more, anything else in the episode that you want to touch on?
Let's see. I think that's it. I thought it was hinky that Davos is he's like bringing Melisandre back to her religion, which would never happen.
Well,
that's okay.
Again, I don't think it's back to her religion, but it's.
Suspend my disbelief.
It's Davos being like, woman. You've done magic before. Like,
the show needs some way to bring John back. Can you please hurry up and bring John back?
Yeah. Actually, it's funny because the actress who plays Melisandre tweeted right after the episode was done, happy now? Question mark.
Yeah. Right, because everyone's super pissed, right?
Everyone
is
pissed.
Burning people alive.
Yeah, right? Exactly. So.
That's cute.
Yeah. And Kit Harington apparently released a statement like, I'm sorry for lying for you for 10 months.
Whatever.
Yeah,
So there's questions that are going to be, the answers in the book will be different, I think, in big, huge ways than the answers in the show. The show has to dumb it down. And and just because of the way it is, and we get inside John, we get inside, you know,
And that's a huge reason why the books are amazing is because... Yeah. Like, the scene I always go back to explain this to people, because people ask me all the time, oh, should I read the books, whatever. Yeah. I'm like, look, if you like the show, that's awesome.
Yep.
If you happen to like reading, you will like these books.
Yep.
And, you know, yes, there are differences, but the things that you get out of the books are...
It's just so much more intense.
Yeah, and the perfect scene to explain this to people is, at least comparatively... is the scene where Cersei's getting walk of shame.
The walk of shame.
And,
that's a good
one. Because the scene in the show is so powerful.
Yep.
And it's so emotional. And you feel it and everything. And they did it so well.
Yep.
And then you read the book about it. And you get inside Cersei's mind while it's going on. And it just brings a completely new perspective to the whole thing.
The whole, like, so Cersei's fascinating because she's absolutely loathsome. Throughout the books.
Yeah.
And you are inside her mind. And so you are, by proxy, by reading these words, you are descending into madness with her.
Yeah.
You are having these paranoid, delusional thoughts about everyone that are just completely off the rocker, but it feels normal. Like, she's normalizing torture.
Yeah.
She's normalizing violence.
She's like, I gotta do it. These are my enemies.
And
you
she
know?
Has this, like, and you're in that. Like, you feel crazy reading her chapters.
Yep.
And so that's the magic of the books. But we're actually going to talk about one specific chapter today because Jamie's too big. He's got too many parts, like, spread across all these books to talk about in depth. And so... what happened was, I was doing a synopsis of the Great Northern Conspiracy, right? We're going to do a podcast and see if we understand this idea of the Great Northern Conspiracy. And so,
and by we, Tana really means her explaining it to me while I drink.
Yes, if I can explain it, if I can distill it down. So I have to make sure that I understand all of the working pieces of the conspiracy and suss out what I think of it and everything. And so I was going
And if you don't know what the Great Northern Conspiracy is, don't worry, we're going to get to it in another episode.
And there's so you're gonna have to keep listening already. Check out literally any other podcast.
Don't Google it. Just come along for the ride with us.
All right, yeah, wait for us.
Wait for us, because we'll have a drink associated with it, and that will be better.
Yes. So I'm going after, I'm trying to, like, you know, check all my facts. Where is everybody located? And I'm listening to the books, and I hear this dream sequence that Jamie has that happens in a chapter where he actually turns, he moves away from Jamie the Selfish into Jamie sort of redeeming his honor. And it's the chapter where he jumps into the bear pit with Brienne in the middle of Storm of Swords. But before he does that, it opens with him and Qyburn and Steelshanks Walton, which is one of Roose Bolton's bannermen, have been ordered to deliver Jamie back to King's Landing from Harrenhal. Okay, so that's the scene. So they ride for a half a day or for a whole day, and then they make their camp. Jamie has just, like, Qyburn has just healed his stump hand, so he's all, like, infected and still feverish. Qyburn brought dream wine. He gives Jamie dream wine, and Jamie falls asleep, and he wants to dream about Cersei naked. Like, that's what he's hoping for.
Come on, baby.
Exactly.
Give me my sister, butt-ass naked.
So he's still super connected to Cersei at that moment. He still, like, loves her. And part of his journey along these books is his moving away from his twin. There's the idea that Jaime and Cersei are two halves of a whole, male and female. If, you know, Cersei has said if she was male, she'd be Jaime. Jaime has said if he was female, he would be Cersei. And then Jaime is moving totally away from her while she is descending into madness. Now, the show has them, like, all up in each other's business still, and Jaime doing whatever douchebaggy thing he's doing with the Faith. Like, he's still kind of douchebag Jaime.
Yeah.
And I think that's all that the show is going to do with Jaime, is keep him in this, like, douchebag corner. And I think it's way more fascinating to talk about him as this evolving white knight.
Well, we know he already gave the sword to Brienne.
Yeah, Oathkeeper.
Yeah, so, and the whole Brienne,
I'm gonna get our shaker.
Yep, we're gonna need some more, of the white Russian style.
That's right, we gotta start.
But I think we already have, Jamie turned a little bit.
Yep. In the show, you're talking about.
When he's with Brienne, you completely see this slow turn.
Well, and I so can't, I don't know the show's what's, history.
What's interesting,
really. I only know where he is right now.
What's interesting is that where he is right now is back with Cersei. She's kind of pulling him back.
Okay.
So maybe what we see with Jaime is kind of like this.
You think the show is going to lead the way with what we're going to see with Jaime in the book?
Maybe. It's possible.
So. Well, I mean, so part of the notes I have are the last time we see Jaime in the book and where he is.
So he's in the Riverlands right now. And he's, if I recall correctly, he's taking River Run, you know, from Edmund Tully.
Yep. We can go over that, yep.
He makes some weird...
Oh, we're already... look at us. We're already getting, like, getting close to white knight status.
I don't want to necessarily use my finger to stir this. Beef jerky?
You know what you're going to do? Yeah, get the beef jerky and stir it. You could have just left the coffee liqueur at the bottom and only drank the white knight stuff. And when it gets down low, just fill it back up. All men must drink, Dave.
All men must drink.
We're getting closer to our white knight status. We're only muddy now. We're no longer black knights. We're moving toward white knight. So I have a thing. I have a very fascinating...
You know what? I like the first drink better.
You do? Huh. How about that? Maybe it's the sweetness of the Kahlua?
Yeah, that... ugh.
Yeah? Maybe too much...
too much Tito's?
Too much vodka.
Too much vodka.
Too much vodka.
Too much vodka.
Let's see.
If you are Russian and you are listening to this, you will think I'm a pussy.
Too much vodka.
Too much vodka.
It's true.
It's true. Da. It's da. Da, you pussy. Da.
If you guys go to your books, view of the hardcover, this is page 504 in Storm of Swords. But basically, Jaime falls asleep. He wants to dream of Cersei naked. So clearly, he's still...
My fingers are really cold now, too. Oh, my God.
You need to really suck it up, dude. You are a weenie.
I'm just... Whatever. So read your chapter.
Let's see here. The fever dreams were also vivid. Naked and alone, he stood, surrounded by enemies, with stone walls all around him pressing close. The rock, he knew. He could feel the immense weight of it above his head. He was home. He was home, and he was whole. He held up his right hand and flexed his fingers to feel the strength in them. It felt as good as sex, as good as swordplay. Four fingers and a thumb.
Can I just pause here? Yeah, I get a text from Lauren. She's in the other room. She can hear me. It's quit being a bitch, David.
Exactly, Dave. We all need you to just suck it up, dude. You have a drinking podcast. You really need to up your game.
God damn it.
If you want, you can add more Kahlua.
No. Sorry, I didn't mean to derail us a little bit.
Let's see. Four fingers and a thumb. He had dreamed that he was maimed, but it wasn't so. Relief made him dizzy. My hand, my good hand. Nothing could hurt him so long as he was whole. All around him stood a dozen tall, dark figures in cowled robes that hid their faces. In their hands were spears. "Who are you?" he demanded of them. "What business do you have in Casterly Rock?" They gave no answer, only prodded him with the points of their spears. He had no choice but to descend. I want you to pay attention to where it is that they bring this guy. Okay? Down a twisting passageway he went. Narrow steps carved from the living rock, down and down. I must go up, he told himself. Up, up, not down. Why am I going down?
Why is he going down?
Below the earth, his doom waited. He knew with the certainty of dream, something dark and terrible lurked there, something that wanted him. Jaime tried to halt, but their spears prodded him on. If only I had my sword, he thinks. Nothing could harm me. The steps ended abruptly on echoing darkness. Jaime had the sense of vast space before him. He jerked to a halt, teetering on the edge of nothingness. A spear point jabbed him at the small of his back, shoving him into the abyss. He shouted, but the fall was short. He landed on his hands and knees upon soft sand and shallow water. There were
a beach?
There were watery caverns deep below Casterly Rock, but this one was strange to him. What place is this? And this is where I want Roy Dotrice to pick it up. Okay, so I made a little, like, clip. Where's Jaime?
Where in the world is Jaime Lannister?
All men must drink!
All men must drink!
I love this guy so much, and his golden hand, and his, like... he was so loyal to Cersei, and she was such a dick.
Well, you better love him, because if your girlfriend ever meets him, she's...
That's true.
She's flipping.
Yep, for no hand Jaime. She would do it for no hand Jaime. Let's see, where are we here?
I mean, he jumped in a bear pit to save his love.
I know. So, I think that the reading picks up here. If it doesn't, I'll fill you guys in.
Sister, why has father brought us here? Us? This is your place, brother. This is your darkness. A torch was the only light in the cavern. A torch was the only light in the world. She turned to go. Stay with me, Jaime pleaded. Don't leave me here alone. But they were leaving. Don't leave me in the dark. Something terrible lived down here. Give me a sword, at least. I gave you a sword, Lord Tywin said. It was at his feet. Jaime groped under the water until his hand closed upon the hilt. Nothing can hurt me so long as I have a sword. As he raised the sword, a finger of pale flame flickered at the point and crept up along the edge, stopping a hand's breadth from the hilt. The fire took on the color of the steel itself, so it burned with a silvery blue light, and the gloom pulled back.
Azor Ahai?
What the fuck, dude? He gets a flaming sword?
Is he a Azor Ahai reborn?
Like, this is some Azor Ahai shit right here.
Sword of the Morning.
What is this? So Jaime's dad gives him a flaming sword? And if the sword is referencing Oathkeeper, and Oathkeeper was ice, and ice is some Lightbringer thing, then maybe, but, like, it's just a dream sword. So let's just say it's a dream sword.
It's a dream sword. But I mean, ice, remember, ice is a replica.
Yeah.
I mean, it's an old replica.
Well, so I don't know. I went looking, because I was like, there are certain things that I believe in my own personal headcanon, and I need to validate them and verify them. Because for a long time, I only had the audiobooks, and so I was not able to, like, easily reference these things. And now I can, and I haven't been able to find where ice is a replica.
Oh.
So I remember reading it. I think it's a world book thing, but I haven't found it. So I'm taking that factoid off the table until I can prove it. We'll come back to it eventually if I can prove it. But I can't find the source material on it. So anyway, feel free to email me.
That's what we need for this studio, by the way.
Which is what?
A cold forged sword.
We need Lightbringer in here?
We need Lightbringer.
Well, if...
Or ice. Or dragon...
I'm pretty sure that we, in South Florida, count as a southern state. And I'm not sure that the others are going to... Like, if we were in northern Canada, we might want...
Well, I don't know. Northern Canada's on fire right now.
Oh, yeah, that's true. Oh, shit, that's true.
Like, legit on fire.
This has been Current Events with Westeros Whenever-ly. Ding dong ding!
If you live in Canada, be warned that your state is probably on fire.
Isn't that in Ontario? Right now there's like a giant... Anyway. But so what the fuck, dude? He's like...
Yeah, what the fuck? Yeah. What the actual fuck?
So I love the way that Roy reads Tywin Lannister. He's a total dick.
Yeah.
And I love it. The line that was... Let me see here. Let me see. Jaime jerks to a halt. There are watery caverns. What is this place? Your place, the voice echoed. It was 100 voices, 1,000. The voices of all the Lannisters since Lan the Clever, who'd lived at the dawn of days. But most of all, it was his father's voice. And beside Lord Tywin stood his sister, pale and beautiful, a torch burning in her hand. Joffrey was there as well, the son they'd made together. And behind them, a dozen more dark shapes with golden hair. Mm. And then it picks up, sister, why has father brought us here? And she says, us, this is your place, brother. And so it's
like... Give me
like,
a sword. I've given you a sword.
Yeah, it's kind of like he's hanging out with the Lannister dead, right?
Yeah.
And so I just want you to keep focusing on this like now, imagery of where he is.
But these people aren't dead. You know, at this
point.
Is
Tywin dead at
this
point?
Tywin's not dead at this point.
Is Joffrey? I can't remember.
Wait, actually...
Because we're in Storm, so we've got all the way through Clash.
So Tywin is dead at this point because Jaime is gone
in the Riverlands
and has already let Tyrion go. Mm. This is after...
Is that right? Yeah.
He lets Tyrion go.
Oh, yeah.
And never owns up to it, but then he's like, I'm out. Peace.
Right. And he goes to the Riverlands. Yep, with... And he says,
so Tywin's dead. We know Cersei's not dead.
She's holding a torch. Maybe the torch is life. Maybe she's the only one holding a torch because she's the only one still alive. Does that match up? Because
it
it's Tywin, Joffrey. Joffrey's dead at this point.
Tywin's dead at this point. And all these shadowy figures of golden hair
So that makes sense. Look at that. Yeah. She's holding the fucking torch because she's alive.
Yeah.
And then, okay, well then, listen to this
So is this a symbolism of Jaime Lannister dying and a Jaime Azor Ahai reborn or something? You know, Jaime the good?
I don't know. Let's listen.
The goodester.
Crouching, listening, Jaime moved in a circle, ready for anything that might come out of the darkness. The water flowed into his boots, ankle deep and bitterly cold. Beware the water, he told himself. There may be creatures living in it, hidden deeps. From behind came a great splash. Jaime whirled toward the sound, but the faint light revealed only Brienne of Tarth, her hands bound in heavy chains. I swore to keep you safe, the wench said stubbornly. I swore an oath. Naked, she raised her hands to Jaime. Sir, please, if you would be so good. The steel links parted like silk. A sword, Brienne begged, and there it was, scabbard, belt and all. She buckled it around her thick waist. The light was so dim that Jaime could scarcely see her, though they stood a scant few feet apart. In this light, she could almost be a beauty, he thought. In this light, she could almost be a knight.
Boom, dude, what? Brian shows up in naked, his fucking dream.
Naked.
And he gives her a flaming sword.
And he says, she's beautiful, yeah, basically, is what she's
saying.
In
this light, she could be a beauty. In this light, she could almost be a knight. So here's the theme of true knight status, right? Like, Brian can never be a true knight because of her, the fact that she was born a woman.
Yeah.
You know, she faces ridicule. She faces all of these, like, threats of violence, and she's just totally out of place. She can never be a knight, according to Westerosi custom. She could almost be a beauty. She could almost be a knight. What is this light that he's seeing her through? Right? The light off his sword and her sword. But what the fuck is that light? What is that supposed to be?
His sword that he wants to give. That he wants to sheath in her.
Yeah. So this is, it's a fascinating chapter, my friends. If you've got the hardcover, what did I say? Page 504, it's worth a reread because you see Jamie, book Jamie, go from not giving a fuck about Brienne. Like, he finds out from Qyburn that they've left her and that Vargo Hoat, you know, he's like, oh, well, her dad will ransom her. And Qyburn says, yep.
Sapphires.
And Qyburn says that we got the ransom, or the raven arrived that morning, and the father will pay 300 gold dragons for Brienne. But he wants sapphires and thinks that the dad is trying to cheat him, and so he's probably just going to murder Brienne.
Yep.
And Jaime is momentarily. Her in the bear pit. Yep. But we don't know about the bear pit yet. We don't know about that. I mean, we know there's a bear at Harrenhal. I think Amory Lorch was fed to him. It doesn't matter. But we don't really, like, the bear thing hasn't even happened yet. Mm-hmm. But he's like, fucking, well, I saved you once, Brienne, you know, they didn't rape you that first night, but you're on your own now. And he kind of doesn't give a fuck. And then he wants to dream of Cersei naked, and then he has this fever dream. This is the next part of it. But Brienne, like, shows up at Jaime's doom on whatever this dark shore is. Here's the next bit.
Night. Brienne's sword took flame as well, burning silvery blue. The darkness retreated a little more. The flames will burn so long as you live, he heard Cersei call. When they die, so must you. Sister, he shouted, stay with me, stay! There was no reply but the soft sound of retreating footsteps. Brienne moved her longsword back and forth, watching the silvery flames shift and shimmer. Beneath her feet, a reflection of the burning blade shone on the surface of the flat black water. She was as tall and strong as he remembered, yet it seemed to Jaime that she had more of a woman shape now. Do they keep a bear down here? Brienne was moving, slow and wary, sword in hand, step, turn, and listen. Each step made a little splash. A cave lion? Dire wolves? Some bear? Tell me, Jaime, what lives here? What lives in the darkness? Doom. No bear, he knew. No lion. Only doom. In the cool, silvery blue light of the swords, the big wench looked pale and fierce. I mislike this place. I'm not fond of it myself. Their blades made a little island of light, but all around them stretched a sea of darkness unending. My feet are wet. We could go back the way they...
Oh, shit. Sorry, guys.
I just got updated that the dream happened before Tywin's death, so...
So, who's updating you?
Lauren's in the other room listening to us, texting me all the shit that we're saying wrong.
Let me see here. I totally stopped it. And he says, I'm not fond of it myself.
Their blades made a little island of light, but all around them stretched a sea of darkness unending.
We need, like,
my feet are
something professional, probably.
We could go back the way they brought us. If you climbed on my shoulders, you'd have no trouble reaching that tunnel mouth.
No, not that kettle mixer.
Then I could follow Cersei. He could feel himself growing hard at the thought and turned away so Brienne would not see.
why does he turn away so Brian won't see? So she says...
Because when you first date a girl, you don't want her to know how easy it is to get you hard.
He starts the chapter without giving a fuck about Brian, right? Like, he's still calling her the wench.
Yeah, but you clearly see this... First off, by the way, I want to cheers to you.
Cheers.
Like we just did.
Yeah.
But again, you were right, because clearly Cersei says when the flame goes out, you die.
Right.
So the fire's life, so she's got a torch, she's still alive.
So I feel like, the fire represents life. I think that's pretty obvious. Lauren could come in here instead of just texting you from the next room. You can join our podcast. We'll see if she comes. Listen, so
Jamie... Susie's eating your books anyway.
Jamie has started to change, right? Like, his idea of Brienne, he starts noticing she has a woman shape. In this light, she could be a beauty.
Yeah.
And here's the trick. The part that I, like, accidentally stopped the recording on, because I thought my phone was going to die. Anyway, she offers to lift Jamie up. You could stand on my shoulders and get up to that ledge that they pushed you off of and climb out of here. And Jamie's thought is, oh, that's a good idea. I could go to Cersei. You know, I could follow Cersei where she went. And he starts getting an erection, and then he, like, a resurrection erection, and then he, like, turns away ashamed. Because why? He doesn't want to show Rhaen? Is he ashamed of his feelings for Cersei?
Maybe he's got a small penis.
I don't think so.
Maybe he's got a small dick and he's just embarrassed about it.
Well, if that is so, there's no indication in the text, Dave, and we have to stay true to the text.
I'm just saying,
it doesn't say one way or another.
Sometimes when you're not a grower and you're a shower, you get erections.
I just watched, not last night, the last night, final night, first night, it's the Seth Rogen movie about
this
Christmas.
This is the end?
No, it's
The night before?
The night before.
Okay.
Kirsten and
I still
just
haven't seen it.
It's so fantastic.
Yeah,
I love
Seth Rogen.
But there's a part where it's like he's a grower and a shower. James is just so easy to talk to, and it's brilliant.
James Franco?
Oh my god, it was so funny. Like, the whole thing was just, it was such a fun movie. So highly recommended. I thought it would be stupid, but it was awesome.
Okay. I will have to watch it now.
Yeah, so what the fuck, dude? Her sword starts flaming up too. And now, here's where I think they are, okay? His feet keep splashing in the water, right? And he doesn't recognize this place.
Okay, yeah.
Well, let's listen to the very next one. There's only two more little audio clips to go. This one's a minute and a half. And let's see if you can make any guesses. Be thinking about, where is Jamie? Because he says something like, I don't recognize this place. And I have an idea. I don't know if it's true, but I have an idea.
Well, let's think. Let's just think.
Well, hold on. Just listen. He'll give you some more clues.
She put a hand on his shoulder, and he trembled at the sudden touch. She's warm. Something comes. Brain lifted her sword to point off to his left. There. He peered into the gloom until he saw it too. Something was moving through the darkness, but he could not quite make it out. A man on a horse. No. Two riders side by side. Down here, beneath the rock, it made no sense. Yet there came two riders on pale horses, men and mounts both armored. Pedestrians emerged from the blackness at a slow walk. They make no sound. Jamie realized no splashing, no clink of mail, no clop of hoof. He remembered Eddard Stark riding the length of Aerys' throne room, wrapped in silence. Only his eyes had spoken, a lord's eyes, cold and grey and full of judgment. Is it you, Stark? Jamie called. Come ahead. I never feared you living. I do not fear you dead. Brian touched his arm. There are more. He saw them too. They were armored all in snow, it seemed to him, and ribbons of mist swirled back from their shoulders. The visors of their helms were closed, but Jaime Lannister did not need to look upon their faces to know them.
Who are they?
I think they're in the crypts of Winterfell.
Yeah? I don't think so. It's not Ned. Spoiler, it's not Ned.
You ruined it.
I know.
Wait,
well,
okay.
Here's the
hilarious thing,
right?
Think about it.
If anybody out there has actually read all these books, we've all read this. And if you're anything like me, when Roy Dotrice got to this part while I was looking for the Great Northern Conspiracy and he read this, I stopped, I paused it, and I was like, okay, Tana, who are these people? And I had no fucking idea. And I was like, oh, God, how do I forget something like that?
Yeah.
And so that's when I knew. It was at that moment that I knew we had to do a little podcast about this little...
And so, who are they?
Who are they? Do you have any guesses? So, here's my idea.
They're armored in snow.
So, ghosts.
Ghosts.
Mists. Okay, mist is coming off them. I mean, they're on armored horses.
The others.
Right?
We've seen
they're
the others
armored
on
in snow.
Yeah, and we've seen them on horses.
Yep.
Dead horses, but we've seen them. Dead mammoths and bears and stuff, too.
We're in agreement that they're dead.
I think we're in agreement that they're dead.
Here's what I have to read to you. This scene, I was like, why does this sound familiar? And I went,
by the way, our drinks are now white.
They are. Mine's a little bit brown, but I wouldn't mind putting a little bit of Kahlua in this guy.
Yeah, like...
I think it would sweeten it up a little bit.
Yeah, too much vodka. Too much vodka.
We like being soiled knights, Dave.
We like, you know,
we're not meant to be true knights. We're not white knight status.
We're not white knights. We don't we don't run around the internet defending people because we're white knights.
Oh, no, we don't.
No. Okay. No. Cheers.
No. I mean, I don't really run around defending most anybody. Here's my idea.
Well, you defended fuckboys earlier.
Well, I do. Yeah, maybe I do. Maybe I
Are
am
you
more
an SJW?
What does that mean?
Social justice warrior?
Isn't SJW Sarah Jessica O. Parker?
That's a P.
Am I a social justice? Yeah, I got a recent Mad Max inspired t-shirt about being a social justice warrior.
Oh yeah?
I plan on wearing it to some comic book conventions.
Okay.
I'm very excited. I'll tweet a picture of it if you guys want to support this cause as well. Anyway, listen. The River Styx. Do you know what that is?
The River Styx.
Yeah.
No.
Think about... maybe high school, Greek mythology, any bells going off?
Zeus?
Yeah.
I mean, that's the only high school mythology, Greek mythology.
The end. My entire knowledge of Greek mythology summed up in one word.
I knew a rap about the Greek gods.
Okay,
hold
give
on.
It to me.
Let me,
I can't
let me
wait
think
to
about
hear
this.
I cannot
wait to let me think about this.
I know a rap.
Hephaestus, we're sure what ugly dude. He married Aphrodite, so don't be rude. Zeus, he's the king of the mountain. He drinks from the nectar something fountain. That's all I got. That's all I remember.
That's awesome.
But there was a whole fucking rap that I think one of our Latin teachers gave us to remember the gods.
My public school education is failing me in this moment. I wish someone had taught me a Greek rap.
That's all I remember, though.
That's good. I know this one.
Yeah.
Only Nickelodeon can explode, implode, give a dog a log or a bag of gritty kitty to the kitty in the city with the mud skipper, Ibrears, a cat without a nose, powdered toast man. Can you stand the insanity?
Where is that from?
It's a Nickelodeon ad from somewhere in the middle 90s about Ren and Stimpy.
Oh.
And I didn't even watch Ren and Stimpy, but the commercial came on so much.
That it is
burned in my brain.
The cat dog theme song is burned in my brain.
It's just like, it's there. It's always there,
yeah,
you know?
Yeah, me too.
Have you seen the movie?
Cat dog. Cat dog.
There's
Alone in the world is a little cat dog.
What's the Pixar movie about the feelings? Joy or something? Whatever it is. They always send like a double mint commercial back up to the brain. Like that's the only Nickelodeon song for me.
That and the only other commercial that I remember from back then was, this is your brain.
This is your brain on drugs.
This is your brain on drugs. And it was like a Cheeto. It was like a one cheese puff.
What?
It was a picture of a brain. This is your brain. And then it was, this is your brain on drugs. And it was a picture of an open head with a Cheeto in it or a cheese doodle.
Spoofing the 80s like fried egg commercials.
Yeah, it was fucking ridiculous. It was just a cheese doodle.
I just remember
a cheese doodle inside.
So my cousin Justin, I think, was afraid to eat eggs because he thought that they were drugs or something.
They were brains on drugs.
I'm getting this like years later, third hand from an aunt who was
I didn't want to eat eggs because I thought they were people's brains who became on drugs.
I was pretty sure that like drugs are bad, but I don't know what they are yet. But eggs, like I'm not sure I want to eat those eggs. So anyway. Okay, so the River Styx, getting back on track.
Oh, yeah.
It's the boundary in Greek mythology between Earth and the underworld.
Oh, okay.
Okay, and so to cross it, you would have to sometimes take a ferry. The ferryman, Charon, whatever his name is.
Hermes?
Yeah, it's like Hades is the ruler.
Hades? Okay. Hades is the ruler of the afterlife, right? Hades.
Yep. And Achilles was dipped in the river Styx, which gave him immortality except for his heel.
Right.
And so I think that Jaime, I'm wondering if Jaime is standing on the edge of...
the river Styx?
Yeah, or like on the edge of the real and the underworld, on the edge of life and
death.
So
you think that...
I'm wondering if that shoreline is life and death.
So if these, if this river line, shoreline is life and death, why are all these dead Lannisters...
They're under the rock, so it could just be like the Lannister version of the crypts. And Cersei, like I said, was the only one, or actually, like you pointed out, was the only one with a torch, and that means she's the only one alive. Joffrey's there, he's dead. The dad is dead. Did we find out if the dad is
dead? No, Tyrion's not dead. Apparently, this happens while Tyrion is still in the Black Cells. So
Tyrion is in the Black Cells.
Yeah,
okay,
which means Tywin's not dead.
So
yet.
So Tywin's not dead yet. Okay.
So this happens when he's still on the way back with Brienne, right?
He just left Brienne.
Brienne is captured. They're captured, and they let him go.
Yep, Roose Bolton was in charge.
Yeah.
And he lets Jaime go.
That's right.
And he gives Brienne to Vargo Hope because he doesn't give a fuck.
Correct.
And when Jaime finds out, he doesn't know this right away.
Oh.
He finds out, and he's like, "Well, I can't help her. It's her own problem." What?
Speaking of Roose Bolton, big thing, go back to the show.
Oh, yeah.
Gets himself stabbed by Ramses.
I just can't. I think I pulled a muscle in my eyeball from rolling my eyes so hard at all of the Ramses stuff. The Walder, and like he feeds her to the dogs, and I can't even. I seriously, with this
you don't
Ramses
think that
story
would
line,
happen in the
I
book?
Can't even. Why on fucking earth would Fat Walder give her baby to Ramsay? And be like, where's my husband? It would never happen. She's a Frey. She's one of the more conniving Freys.
Yeah.
This would never happen. The Maester isn't going to go scuttling off and obeying Ramsay either. It doesn't end well for him. None of the Ramsay storyline, A, makes any sense, or B, is believable for me personally. I get that he's a favorite, but... he always looked like a hobbit to me. I'm not afraid of that guy.
He does kind of look like a hobbit.
I just can't even with that storyline. But yeah, so he stabs his dad as if Roose Bolton wouldn't see that coming.
Yeah. Yeah. You know what?
You'll always be my number one son, boy.
Now that you think about that, I mean...
come on.
He knows exactly who his son is.
Yep.
And he knows
that... oh, your heir, the heir to my kingdom was just born. Give me a hug, son. That would never... it just goes against everything we know about the Boltons.
That's true. Absolutely true.
And the guy that's in the room that's in on it, too, a Karstark. It just... I don't know. This is one of the places
That, I think, could be believable.
Right.
Because we know that... we do know that Karstark's pissed off because they chopped off his head.
However, in the book, just to bring this back around... Jon Snow facilitates the saving wedding of the young Karstark, Alice Karstark, Karstark, to the Magnar of Fen, and saves her because she was going to be married off to an evil uncle, like Arnoff Karstark's son or something, and then they were just going to get a child on her and murder her and take her birthright, and then these evil uncles would take over that family.
That's right.
Jon Snow facilitates, with Melisandre's help and Queen Selyse's help, facilitates a marriage to a wildling that has an army of wildlings, the Magnar
of Fen.
To protect
her, right.
And so he fixes this Karstark problem. So if Jon Snow rises up to be... Lord of Winterfell for a while, let's say.
Karstarks are coming.
The Karstarks have his back. The ones that matter have his back. And Stannis, spoilers, by the end of the books, or the spoiler chapter, arrests the Karstarks' evil uncles, Arnoff, and the conspirators, and kills them.
Yep.
And so now we have the Karstarks ready to be taken back into the fold of the Starks. But I get that the show has to be the show.
Yeah.
But I just, the Ramsay storyline, I can't even... ugh, I just can't even.
Okay, back on Jaime.
Oh, so I think it's the River Styx. I think that he's on the edge of the underworld. And here is the big payoff. Who were those misty characters?
This is where we get to blow our loads?
This is it. You're going to blow your load, man.
Really?
Because nothing... this
I'm not
is,
wearing underwear.
This is the second... gross. This is the second most important dream sequence since Ned's vision of the Tower of Joy. Are you ready for this shit?
This is Ned's vision?
No, this is the second most. So it goes Ned's vision of the Tower of Joy.
Yeah.
Then this vision.
Okay.
That's how important this thing is.
All right. And I probably glossed right over it.
And you don't even remember it. Yeah. I didn't even remember it.
Yeah.
This is like, so I was like, we got to put a point on this. Okay, here it is with the amazing Roy Dotrice. Go download the audiobook.
Five had been his brothers. Oswald Went and John Derry. Lewin Martell, a Prince of Dawn. The White Bull and Gerald Hightower. Sir Arthur Dane, Sword of the Morning. And beside them, crowned in mist and grief, with his long hair streaming behind him, rode Rhaegar Targaryen, Prince of Dragonstone, and rightful heir to the Iron Throne. You don't frighten me, he called, turning as they split to either side of him. He did not know which way to face. I will fight you one by one or all together. But who is there for the wench to duel? She gets cross when you leave her out. I swore an oath to keep him safe, she said to Rhaegar's shade. I swore a holy oath. We all swore oaths, said Sir Arthur Dane, so sadly. The shades dismounted from their ghostly horses. When they drew their long swords, it made not a sound. He was going to burn the city, Jaime said, to leave Robert only ashes. Here is your king, said Derry. You swore to keep him safe, said Went. And the children, them as well, said Prince Lewin. Prince Rhaegar burned with a cold light, now white, now red, now dark. I left my wife and children in your hands. I never thought it hurt them. Jaime's sword was burning less brightly now. I was with the king. Killing the king, said Sir Arthur, cutting his throat. Said Prince Lewin. The king you had sworn to die for, said the White Bull. The fires that ran along the blade were guttering out, and Jaime remembered what Cersei had said. No! Terror closed a hand about his throat. Then his sword went dark, and only Brienne's burned as the ghost came rushing in. No, he said, no, no, no! Heart pounding, he jerked awake and found himself in starry darkness amidst a grove of trees. He could taste bile in his mouth, and he was shivering with sweat, hot and cold at once.
Boom. How about that for some shit? Rhaegar comes back from the dead.
It's his fucking...
the murder of his children and wife at Jamie's fucking feet.
It's the fucking Kingsguard. His brothers.
His sworn brothers. There's also a theory that Arthur Dane or Gerald Hightower aren't dead. They're fucking dead. They're dead.
Yeah.
So, dead. Anyway. I think that they're living in dream, if this dream is to be believed. So, fucking Rhaegar comes back. Dave, we read this! This is in the book we read!
I don't remember it.
And it just glossed over! And I think this is one of the most important dream sequences in the whole, since the Tower of Joy.
Oh my god.
Arthur Dane. Then we have Prince Lewin of Dorne, who probably became a Kingsguard just like Loras Tyrell did to protect his sister. Right? Like he goes to protect his blood.
That's right.
And he's looking at Jaime and he's like, what about the children? And my fucking sister? What about them? And Jamie's response is, I didn't know he was going to do that. And I think that he's talking about is Robert. His dad.
Oh, I thought Robert.
No, I thought Tywin. Because Tywin orders Gregor and Aemery Lorch to scale the walls of the Red Keep. He thought maybe, what, they're just going to get taken captive?
Right.
But instead they get murdered, raped, like smashed ahead the wall. Like violent, horrific deaths. And Jamie's like, I had no idea he was going to do that. And it's Jamie's pride that keeps him from telling Ned Stark. I think the importance of Ned, him thinking that it's Ned riding up, is because when Jamie is lounging in the Iron Throne, and by the way, I found an amazing illustration of it. It's on our Podbean site.
This is
the picture for tonight. And it's some artist, Marek, it's at the bottom of the illustration. But it's Jaime in his golden armor, draped across the Iron Throne, holding his bloody sword, waiting. Like, this is the view that Ned Stark would have when Ned came into the throne room.
What are you doing on the throne?
And if Jaime was like, dude, he was gonna burn the city to the fucking ground, then maybe Ned would understand. Or at least, like, there would be a conversation and he didn't have to be labeled as the Kingslayer. Right. But his pride, Jaime's ferocious, lion, defiant pride, whatever, his ego gets in his way, and he's like, who are you to judge me, Ned Stark? And never says a word about it until he's taken his, like, fever dream bath with Brienne and confesses to the wildfire.
Which thing. Doesn't make sense to me. You would think that he would be like, yep, I did it for the city.
Mm-hmm. But he's like, who are you to fucking judge me? You're no one to me. I don't need to explain myself to you. And then he just, like, what, drops his sword and walks out?
Yeah, basically.
Yeah, and never tells anybody why he killed the king. He just kind of eats the fact that he's the Kingslayer. Because he also swore an oath to protect the innocent, right? Like, yeah.
Well, he makes that comment, like, I swore an oath to protect the king. I swore an oath to protect the innocent. Yep. What do I do when I'm in conflict? So
I think that River Styx, or some sort of, like, underworld imagery, is the shore where we are.
Yeah.
And the dead are coming over from the land of the dead to lay their grievances at Jaime's feet, and he finds that it's his doom, right? Like, his sword goes out, and the only one there
is Brienne.
Is Brienne, because she's there to, like, defend him.
Well, because she swore an oath to keep him safe and get him back to... Yep. To King's Landing.
If you guys go back, and I highly recommend going back and rereading this chapter, again, page 508 is where it ends on Storm of Swords, it then gets super funny, because that's when Jaime goes back, it's the middle of the night, he woke up from this dream, he demands that they go back to Harrenhal, he says that he forgot something there, he barters with Steel Shank Walton, like, promises him some gold, they go back. They find Brienne the next morning, they get there in the morning, and she's fighting the bear. And at first he doesn't know that she's fighting the bear with a fake sword.
Yeah.
When he realizes it, he jumps into the bear pit barehanded, and also he has a rotten stump for one of his hands. And it's a really awesome scene. If you pay attention, he stops calling her the wench, and he starts thinking of her as Brienne after this dream. Before the dream, it was like, fuck her. She's on her own. I want Cersei. Cersei abandons him in his dream. And now he's, like, paying attention to Brienne. And this is the first time, I think, that he says... So, he put his... I'll pay her bloody ransom, he says to Vargo Hoat. Gold, sapphires, whatever you want. Pull her out of there. You want her? Go get her. So he did. He put his good hand on the marble rail and vaulted over, rolling as he hit the sand. The bear turned at the thump, sniffing, watching this new intruder warily. Jaime scrambled to one knee. Well, what in seven hells do I do now? He filled his fist with sand. Kingslayer? He heard Brienne say, astonished. Jaime. He uncoiled, flinging the sand in the bear's face. And so they, like, fight together, and she keeps saying things like, Kingslayer, and he's like, Jaime. And then he'll say the wench, and she's like, Brienne.
Brienne, yeah.
And so it's like they're moving closer together, and you can watch it sort of unfold like that. So, Vargo says, you flew my bear, Vargo Hoat shrieked. And I'll serve you the same if you give me trouble, Steel Shanks threw back. We're taking the wench. Her name is Brienne, said Jaime. Brienne, the Maid of Tarth. You are still maiden, I hope. Her broad, homely face turned red. Yes. Oh, good, Jaime said. I only rescue maidens. It's so great. It's such a great scene. It's such a fun...
The bear, and the maiden fair.
Yeah, and, like, at the end of it, she says, Sir Jaime, even in soiled pink satin and torn lace, Brienne looked more like a man in a gown than a proper woman. I'm grateful, but you were well away. Why come back? A dozen quips came to mind, each crueler than the one before. But Jaime only shrugged. I dreamed of you, he said. Like, that's the fucking scene! Oh, it's so good! Rhaegar Targaryen comes back from the grave, and like yells at Jaime. Yeah.
Drops it on him. Says, "You fucking asshole! You killed what my children.
You were supposed to protect my wife and kids, asshole." Oh, it's such a powerful moment.
Let alone, to be fair, yeah. Rhaegar's like, "Protect my wife and kids while I'm off fucking Lyanna and making another one." Hello.
It's also in this chapter that we get this fascinating glimpse into Jaime's, like, so he thought he was a badass because he was all like, "I'm the youngest Kingsguard ever in a generation. I'm so fancy." And it's, he thinks this. So it's at the tourney of Harrenhal.
Okay.
Where Rhaegar crowns Lyanna.
Okay.
Queen of Love and Beauty.
Gives her his favor.
Yep. That Jaime, who's 14, I think, at the time, is raised up to a Kingsguard knight, right? It's a huge honor.
Yeah.
And it's in front of...
Well, we know he's like an excellent swordsman. Yep. I mean, and he is the best swordsman in the land. Yeah.
So King Aerys made a great show. This is on page 501 of that chapter. King Aerys made a great show of Jaime's investiture. He said his vows before the king's pavilion, kneeling on the green grass in white armor while half the realm looked on. When Sir Gerald Hightower raised him up and put the white cloak about his shoulders, a roar went up that Jaime still remembered all these years later. But that very night, Aerys had turned sour, declaring that he had no need of 7 Kingsguard here at Harrenhal. Jaime was commanded to return to King's Landing to guard the queen and little Prince Viserys, who had remained behind. Even when the White Bull offered to take that duty himself so that Jaime might compete in Lord Went's tourney, Aerys had refused him. "He'll win no glory here," the king had said. "He's mine now, not Tywin's. He'll serve as I see fit. I'm the king, I rule, and he'll obey." That was the first time that Jaime understood. It was not his skill with sword or lance that had won him his white cloak, nor any feats of valor that he'd performed against the Kingswood Brotherhood. Aerys had chosen him to spite his father, to rob Lord Tywin of his heir. And he sends Jaime away from the greatest party of a generation.
Mm-hmm.
Go home, kiddo. Oh, it's heartbreaking. Jaime wants to rip the cloak off, but half the realm saw him swear to his fealty to this guy. He gets sent off to do nothing in an empty castle.
Well, when you guys are best friends and then you fuck someone's wife and then you get unbest friended, some fucking spite and rage there and is, shit comes up, you
there's
know?
There's some fallout, my friends. I mean, there's some fallout.
If there's any lesson you'll learn from this podcast, is don't fuck your best...
What is the lesson, Dave? What should our listeners take away as their lesson?
Don't fuck your best friend's wife.
Don't be a mad king.
Don't say that. Don't burn your city down.
I feel like there are a lot of lessons we can learn.
Put Kahlua in all of your drinks.
Yeah, this would be better with Kahlua.
It would be better with Kahlua.
Live and learn. Jaime, being a white knight is not all it's cracked up to be, my friend.
No, it's not.
No.
Did we hit everything that you wanted to talk about?
I'm checking my notes now. All right.
That was perfect timing, too. I don't know how you do this every time.
Do we?
Yeah.
I feel like we always go over.
No, I mean, if we go 7 minutes over, no big deal. It's, you know, it's a...
Do we have some time that we're supposed to be hitting every week?
No, there's no target, really. Yeah. I think I like to keep them, like, at about an hour, because I think after an hour, people are just like, oh, my God.
Stop fucking talking.
I
did... There's a couple other things I would like us to touch on, so we might have a few more minutes in the podcast here.
Yeah, of course. Okay. Bring it on.
Like
I said, we're not aiming for a goal. It's just... You know,
you could aim to put a little more Kahlua in our tumbler.
I could. I could be just happily buzzed at this point.
Here we go. All men must drink. Yeah. You need to top off, my friend.
I'm pretty happy with this overlay. Buzz going.
Book Jaime is introduced to us as the Kingslayer. He has shit for honor. He is actively cuckolding the king of the realm by fucking the king's wife. He pushes a kid off a tower like some incest monster. He's golden, defiant, vain, worth
living. Oh man, I saw a great 8-bit animation that was like a new game.
Yep.
And all it was
It's mostly water.
It was Jaime Lannister pushing like Bran out a window.
Yeah.
And then he goes and fucks Cersei. And it's just like the new Tetris game. No. Push fuck. Push fuck. Jesus. It was kind of funny.
It's fucked up, man. That's fucked up.
I saw it on Reddit.
It's really fucked up. Let's
What did you expect from Reddit?
Continue with my synopsis. It isn't until he's captured by Rob, set free by Catelyn, and battles with Brienne, confessing in his too hot bath with his missing rotten stump hand, to having saved King's Landing from the wildfire, that we as readers start seeing Jaime as anything but this vain douchebag.
Douchebag, yeah.
And it's from that moment that he starts, I think, the moving away, but it's this chapter that we just read where he really, that's his turn. He moves away consciously from Cersei, thinking he could follow her up and out of that thing by standing on Brienne's back,
yep.
Or he could stay and fight his demons. Let me see. Where are we here? He chooses to stay. He's moving away from his twin psychopath, both physically and emotionally. He seems to be regaining his lost honor. He chooses to stay on as the Lord Commander of the Kingsguard, even when his overproud father insists that he take his place as the rightful heir of Casterly Rock. And that's a huge deal. If he were to abdicate, he would be a great lord. He would be the Warden of the West. He'd be able to have sex with not his sister, which maybe doesn't appeal to Jaime at this point, but like he could have kids and a family and, you know, like social ties. He could leave behind the soiled white cloak that gave him this nickname, and he would be starting over at the very top of the mountain.
Yeah.
He'd be Lord of Casterly Rock. Warden of the West. That's huge. And instead he says no, and he stays as the Kingsguard Knight, as the Lord Commander of the Kingsguard, which is a huge deal.
Yeah. We know that's a huge big shift. I mean, he even opens up that Lord Commander of Night's Watch yep. book and yeah. starts filling it out. Like,
he gets so he sad takes, about like how small his page is.
Yeah, he takes his... But I think he also takes his duty so seriously now. Mm-hmm. He's like, I need to change my reputation. Yep. I'm not an oath breaker. Yep. I'm not a king slayer.
I hope we see him become a badass fighter, like a fighter of legend, where he goes from even being right-handed to left-handed. Left-handed,
yep. Yeah, even with one hand.
I mean,
yeah.
That's something to sing about, my friends. Yep, and his father disowns him. Like, Tywin does not take that sitting down. Like, he disowns Jaime. And he dies with Jaime hating him and him hating Jaime. Cersei loathes him. Tyrion all but spits venom in his face once Jaime confesses that Tysha was real. So this guy's got nothing going on. And the last time that we see him is in the Riverlands. This is the last time we see Jaime on page. Quote, it was near midnight when two scouts came riding back with a woman that they had taken captive. He's on his way. He's just settled everything in the Riverlands.
Yeah.
And now he's moving. He's like, all that remains to me is to go back to Cersei. And so he's not like looking forward to it in the way that he was at the beginning of this chapter.
No,
he
of
was
course
just
not.
Like, he's just like, I guess that's where I'm headed next. So Brienne rides up. She rode up, bold as you please, my lord, demanding words with you. Jaime scrambled to his feet. My lady, I had not thought to see you again so soon. Gods be good. She looks 10 years older than when I saw her last. And what's happened to her face? That bandage. You've been wounded. A bite. She touched the hilt of her sword, the sword he had given her. Oathkeeper. My lord, you gave me a quest. The girl. Have you found her? I have, said Brienne, maid of Tarth. Where is she? A day's ride. I can take you to her, sir, but you will need to come alone. Elsewise, the Hound will kill her. Dun, dun, dun. That's the last time we see Jaime on page. It's not the last time we see Brienne, though. Or maybe, I don't remember what order this happens.
There's, it has to be the last time we see her because...
It is, yeah.
Because
we see that after we see her getting hanged.
Yes.
Yeah. So Brienne has just saved the orphan, and Brienne, it runs concurrent, but there's, like, a bunch of other chapters in between this stuff.
Yeah.
So to find out, like, when the last time we saw these guys was takes a bit of doing, but the last time that we see Brienne, she's just saved the orphans at that inn where Gendry is, right?
Yeah.
From Biter and Rorsch. Gendry was there, she was bringing him a plate of food. And she was about to tell him that he looked like Renly.
Yeah, she immediately says...
She thought it was a ghost. She thought it was Renly.
Is that fucking Renly?
Yep. She was like, who's this guy? But he's so angry. He's got, like, that all that anger. Which is really cool to think about Gendry being a laughing storm reborn.
Yeah.
You know, like a new lord of Storm's End. I don't know how he would get there, but it's interesting that he exists. But Brienne is about to go tell him, hey, dude, you're the son of a king.
And
Rorg
and Biter show up and...
Yep, and a dozen other guys or six other guys.
And she says, fuck off, and pulls out a sword and starts fighting.
She knows they're impossible odds. This is what we love about Brienne. It's like 6 against 1 or 7 against 1. And she just says, this is what she has to do. So she draws Oathkeeper and she goes at him. I think she kills Rorg. I think the way it works is she kills Rorg and then Biter tackles her. And they tussle, and then he starts eating her face. Yeah. And then he dies because somebody, Gendry maybe, or Lem Lemoncloak comes back. Yeah. Somebody sticks a sword through his face, and his tongue grows longer. But yeah, so she passes out when half of her face is being chewed off by Biter, just seconds before somebody stuffs a sword through his brain. And then it says her face, so then she wakes up. She's under the ground. She's with the Brotherhood Without Borders. Banners. Brotherhood. No.
Lady Stoneheart.
Yep. And she doesn't realize...
Doctors Without Borders.
Different thing, Tana. Different thing. But so she wakes up and Thoros of Myr is having a real crisis of faith. And he's all, I knew who we were once. But now I don't know what the fuck we're doing, because he sees them hanging a lot of innocent people. But then it says, so Brienne comes face to face with Lady Stoneheart, who is Catelyn Stark, who she swore her sword to.
Yep.
But then Catelyn was murdered. And it says this. This is the last time, I think, that we see Brienne on page.
Well.
I think. Because then she doesn't appear. Like, this is her point of view.
Well, the Biter incident has to happen before she sees Jaime.
Yep.
Yeah.
And then, so the Biter thing happened, and then she comes for Jaime. That was the last time we see Jaime.
Yep.
A day's ride, I can take you to her, sir, but you'll have to come alone, elsewise the Hound will kill her.
Right.
And then that's the end of the Jaime chapter. It goes on to, like, I don't know, Daenerys or something. And then eventually we come back to, or rather, this happened before that, and this is the Brienne chapter. Okay?
Before that.
Yep, before that.
So the last time we see Brienne is with Jaime.
The last time we see Brienne in a Brienne chapter is this one.
Okay, yeah. Okay.
And then we see Brienne as like a cameo in a Jaime chapter.
Yeah.
Okay, so here it is. Her face, Brienne thought. Her face was so strong and handsome. Her skin so smooth and soft. Lady Catelyn? Tears filled her eyes. They said that you were dead. She is, said Thoros of Myr. The phrase slashed her throat from ear to ear. When we found her by the river, she was 3 days dead. Harwin begged me to give her the kiss of life, but it had been too long. I could not do it. So Lord Beric put his lips to hers instead. And the flame of life passed from him to her. And she rose. May the Lord of Light protect us. She rose. Am I dreaming still? Brienne thinks. Is this another nightmare born from my Biter's teeth? I never betrayed her. Tell her that. I swear it by the Seven. I swear it by my sword. The thing that had been Catelyn Stark took hold of her throat again, fingers pinching the ghastly, long slash in her neck, and choked out more sounds. Words are wind, she says, said the Northman. She says that you must prove your faith. How? With your sword. Oathkeeper, you call it? Then keep your oath to her, m'lady. What does she want of me? She wants her son alive, or the man who killed her dead, or the men who killed her dead, said the big man. She wants to feed the crows like they did at the Red Wedding. Freys and Boltons, aye. We'll give her those, as many as she likes. All she asks from you is Jaime Lannister. Dun dun dun! Jaime. The name was a knife, twisting in her belly. Lady Catelyn, you do not understand. Jaime, he saved me from being raped when the Bloody Mummers took us, and later he came back for me. He leapt into the bear pit, empty-handed. I swear to you, he is not the man he was. He sent me after Sansa to keep her safe. He could not have been a part of the Red Wedding. Lady Caitlin's fingers dug deep into her throat, and the words came rattling out, choked and broken, a stream as cold as ice. The Northman said, "She says that you must choose. Take the sword and slay the Kingslayer, or be hanged for a betrayer. The sword or the noose, she says. Choose, she says. Choose."
Clearly she chose to live, because she goes and lies to Jaime, we think.
But she doesn't choose at that moment. She can't. Brienne is paralyzed because she's torn between these two impossible things. So she says nothing. So they make the decision to hang her, Sir Hyle Hunt, and Podrick Payne, who's just a kid. He's Tyrion's squire that's been hanging out and, like, working with Brienne.
Yeah.
And when she sees Pod's, like, skinny little neck be jerked up into the tree, and now they fit her with a noose, and Lem is about, he's yanking her up into the tree at the same time, Pod's, like, legs start jerking, and he starts dying, and she's watching this innocent kid die. And that's when, so she sees his legs twitching, dying, and it says, quote, "Brienne sucked the air in desperately, even as the rope was strangling her. Nothing had ever hurt so much. She screamed a word." And then the chapter ends, and that's it. And for what feels like years, I wanted to know what that word was. And I would, like, think about what that word could have been. Like, what does she scream to make that stop? And years later, George would announce, like, there was a discussion with some fans, and he asked if anybody had sorted it out. Did anybody figure out what the word was? And do you know what the word is, Dan?
Sword.
It's sword! The word is sword. Because Catelyn gives her the choice. The noose
or the sword.
Or the sword.
And she goes sword.
And she screams out sword. And she, like, all the clues are there. She rattles the hilt when she goes to get Jaime in his chapter.
Mm-hmm.
The word sword is italicized a couple of times. She thinks about the sword. So it's all there. I think maybe if I had been reading the books, I want to believe I would have got it. But yeah. I didn't. How'd you get it? Did you
glimpse at your notes.
You looked at my notes.
I looked at your notes. And on that note, ladies and gentlemen,
I think that's it.
I think that's our beautiful episode on what we believe to be a bad Jaime gone good.
Yeah, a bad Jaime gone good, and I like him good.
I like him
Are we gonna?
Are we gonna what?
Well, what's gonna happen with Jaime in the future, Dave?
Well,
what happens with him? What the fuck happens?
We know Brienne goes and gets him. And then maybe brings him.
Hang him?
I don't think so. I think they're gonna.
What happens?
You know what? And this may be fucking nuts.
Well,
and
wait,
it may be crackpot.
Just.
I think.
Throw something.
I think.
Throw up a layup. Throw a Hail Mary.
Let me get it out, God damn it, woman.
Hail Mary. I'm running to the end zone. Throw me the Hail Mary.
These sports, I don't understand these sports
references.
I'm running.
References. I'm jeeking and ducking.
I think Thoros of Mir is gonna be like, "Listen, ladies. Caitlin, you got this man here.
Mm-hmm.
You can't just hang him. It's time to let the gods decide."
She has to have a
and
plan.
I think,
what's her plan with Jaime?
I think there's going to be a trial by combat.
Okay.
And Jaime Lannister. This is where he proves himself as a left-handed swords
master. His life depends on it.
His life depends on it. He proves himself a left-handed sword master.
Yeah.
And he wins.
He has been practicing.
He wins his life. Just like
Brienne?
The Hound did.
But what if they make him fight Brienne?
I don't think they will.
I don't think they will either.
I don't think they
will. What if they did? What if they're like, you have to kill each other? Only one of you can win.
I don't think
that'll happen.
I think they kill each other and they die together and live
so
forever.
Dave, we can't be done yet. I need more of your time.
More?
I do, yeah. I need more of your time. Because in this light of beauty, we have to talk about the Valonqar prophecy. At least for a minute. We got to take 5 minutes
All
right, and talk about it.
Lay it on us. Let's do it.
We got to.
Let's do it.
Do you remember what the prophecy for Cersei is?
I'm kind of drunk and I'm out of drink. So.
This is the apex of the pyramid, my friend.
The apex? All right. Yep. Lay it on us. Let's drop the bombshell.
All right. It's all... So those are the notes I've already gone through. Okay, listen.
Oh, man. You still have 3 pages of notes. 4, 5... Jesus
no, these
Christ,
some
women.
Of these are from the beginning. Okay, Valonqar theory. Okay, I gotta find it. Maggie the Frog, the old crone.
Oh yeah.
That made the prophecy for Cersei.
Right.
This is what it said. Right? Will I marry the prince? She asked. Never. Well,
we know the beauty is coming up because Brie, you know,
in this light of beauty,
will replace her. Yeah.
This is the thing. So here's the Valonqar prophecy, and this is why Brienne is so important to Jaime, because she's gonna usurp fucking Cersei, and Cersei doesn't see it coming, but we do because we're paying attention. So here it is. The excerpt is, if you're reading on your iPad, 4,690. That's the page of the Valonqar prophecy. In the dim green tent, the blood seemed more black than red. Black blood. Maggie's toothless mouth trembled at the sight of it. Here, she whispered, give it here. When Cersei offered her hand, she sucked away the blood with gums as soft as a newborn babe's. The queen could still remember how queer and cold her mouth had been. Three questions you may ask, the crone said once she'd had her drink. You will not like my answers. Ask or be gone with you. Go, the dreaming queen had thought. Hold your tongue and flee. But the girl did not have sense enough to be afraid.
Of course not. She's Cersei Lannister.
She's fucking Cersei. When she was a kid, she was even worse. When will I marry the prince? She asked. Never. You will wed the king. Beneath her golden curls, the girl's face wrinkled up in puzzlement. Susie would like some beef jerky.
Kitty?
She's there. She wants it.
There you go.
La 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 la. She thought that she wouldn't marry Rhaegar until he was the king. Will I be queen, though? Asked the younger her. Aye. Malice gleamed in Maggie's yellow eyes. Queen you shall be, until there comes another, younger and more beautiful, to cast you down and take all that you hold dear.
That could be Marjorie.
That's the thing. That's what we think, right? Yeah. Anger flashed across the child's face. If she tries, I will have my brother kill her. Let's see. Even then she would not stop, willful child as she was. She still had one more question due to her, one more glimpse into her life to come. Will the king and I have children? She asked. Take it easy now. Oh, aye. 6 and 10 for him, and 3 for you. That made no sense to Cersei. Her thumb was throbbing where she'd cut it, and her blood was dripping on the carpet. How could that be? She wanted to ask, but she was done with her questions. The old woman was not done with her, however. Gold shall be their crowns and gold their shrouds, she said. And when your tears have drowned you, the Valonqar shall wrap his hands about your pale white throat and choke the life from you. What does Valonqar mean, Dave?
I don't know.
It means little brother in High Valyrian.
Does it really?
Yeah, if you read ahead of my notes, you'd know that. It means little brother.
Oh, look at that.
Yep. And we know that Jaime, here's why we have to talk about this. Jaime is her little brother.
By only a little bit. But so is Tyrion.
Yep. Well, she thinks it's Tyrion, so we know that Cersei gets everything wrong, right? Like, she thinks that this prophecy is about Margaery. She thinks the Valonqar is Tyrion. She doesn't see what's right in front of her. It says this is how we know Jaime was born second. It's back in Game of Thrones when Ned is, like, trying to catch Cersei out in the Godswood and is like, aha, I know you have incest babies. And she's like, I don't give a fuck.
Yeah.
Your brother, said Ned, or your lover? Both. She did not flinch from the truth. Since we were children together, and why not? The Targaryens wed brother to sister for 300 years to keep the bloodlines pure. And Jaime and I are more than just brother and sister. We are one person in two bodies. We shared a womb together, and here's the trick. He came into the world holding my foot, our old maester said. When he is in me, I feel whole. If you're holding somebody's foot and they're going down the birth canal,
you're coming out second.
Are you first or second in that line?
You're second.
You're second. You're the little brother.
It's assuming you come out head first, though.
Well, it doesn't matter. Well, I mean, you'd have to, right?
He could be pulling her out.
He was hanging onto her foot.
If he came out foot first.
Oh, that's a good point, Dave. You know what I'm saying? I don't think anyone's thinking that Jaime comes out and he's hanging onto Cersei who's still in the womb.
He's like, bitch, come out. It's time to go.
If it turns out that this prophecy doesn't come true, we're going to go right to this moment and say, Dave called it.
Dave called it.
Jamie came out first. It was like a water slide birth, you know? Like, the kids just come out, but he's reaching back.
No, he's coming out. He's like, bitch, come on. Let's go, Cersei. It's time to go.
It's like she wanted to stay in.
No, you're probably right. You're probably right. She comes out first, and he's, you know, bring me with you.
Yeah.
It's either bitch, come on, or bring me with you.
Yep. So that makes him younger. So yeah. He could be the little brother. So that's number one. Number two, one younger and more beautiful will cast you down and take all that you hold dear.
Well, who's more beautiful to Jamie at this point?
That's Brienne. The thing.
He even says it.
In this light.
In this light, she could she be beauty. She was a beauty.
Yeah. Whatever the fuck it was.
Yeah, something like that.
In this light, she could be beautiful. In this light, she could be a knight. Like, he's starting to think about her as beautiful. Also, the prophecy is made by a toothless old crone. Who would the crone think is beautiful? Some, like, all-surface Cersei? Or somebody inner that's, beauty. Like, yeah, yeah, inner beauty, that's, like, honorable and, you know, honest and upstanding, would do anything.
That's true.
To keep her vows. So, beauty in the eye of the beholder, maybe?
Yeah.
I'm just saying, this could be...
I like
be,
it.
This could be the way this is playing out. And we see Jaime turning away from Cersei and turning toward Brienne.
Yeah.
In fact, we get this this other thing. Doo-doo-doo. In the epilogue of Dance, Kevin Lannister is talking to Cersei and he's like, dude, you gotta prepare yourself. Jaime's probably dead. And she says this, you've not asked about your brother, Kevin said. Cersei lifted her chin, her green eyes shining in the candlelight. Jaime, have you had word? None, Cersei. You may need to prepare yourself, for if he were dead, I would know it. We came into this world together, uncle. He would not go without me. Like, that's one of the last things we hear in Dance with Dragons. That's the last thing, one of the last things that George gives us before going radio silent for years. Mm. So, Valonqar. So, moving on. Two, younger, more beautiful, Marjorie. I don't think it's going to be Marjorie. I think it's going to be Brienne.
I think absolutely it's Brienne, yeah.
Here's a quote about another beauty thing, okay?
Read it.
Beauty, they called her, mocking. The hair beneath the visor, this is a Catelyn chapter. The hair beneath the visor was a squirrel's nest of dirty straw, and her face. Brienne's eyes were large and very blue. A young girl's eyes, trusting and guileless. But the rest, her features were broad and coarse, her teeth prominent and crooked, her mouth too wide, her lips so plump that they seemed swollen. 1,000 freckles speckled her cheeks and her brow, and her nose had been broken more than once. Pity filled Catelyn's heart. Is there any creature on earth as unfortunate as an ugly woman? And yet, when Renly cut away her torn cloak and fastened a rainbow one in its place, Brienne of Tarth did not look unfortunate. Her smile lit up her face, and her voice was strong and proud as she said, "My life for yours, your grace. From this day on, I am your shield. I swear it by the old gods and the new." The way she looked at the king, looked down at him. She was a good hand higher, though Renly was nearly as tall as his brother had been, was painful to see. Like, she's being called beauty throughout the book, but it's just a mocking version of beauty.
Yeah, I think, no, I'm in.
And then...
You sold me on that.
There's a third part to the prophecy. What was it? A younger, more beautiful will come to cast you down. Maybe that was only the two parts. And then it all her, the golden gold shrouds of the kids.
Yeah, and
Myrcella,
I mean,
died.
Myrcella died in the show, and it was a great callback to that prophecy.
Yeah, gold was the shroud.
Gold, yeah, she asks Tommen, what was she wearing, the red dress or the crimson or the gold?
And she seemed to already know it was going to be gold.
Yeah, and he says the gold, and she says something like...
Have they talked about the prophecy in the show?
There was a scene.
There was?
Yep. There was a scene,
so
a flashback.
So I think that this is an important thing.
Yeah,
and then
absolutely.
Cersei says that thing about Jaime, he wouldn't leave without me.
Yeah.
And so the Valonqar to choke the life from you. So I saw a thing on Reddit. This is not my, like, work, this particular part, but I thought it would be cool to share it. If Jaime ends up killing Cersei, let's say he strangles her with his golden hand.
Yeah.
Right? Then we have some really interesting and pretty specific parallels between the two Lannister brothers. Okay, and here they are. So Tyrion and Jaime. It's kind of creepy. They're both Kingslayers. One killed Joffrey. One killed Mad King Aerys.
Yeah.
They'd both be Kinslayers.
This is assuming that Jaime Lannister kills Cersei.
Yep, okay. Assuming that that happens, then Tyrion would have killed Lady Joanna and Joff. No, he doesn't kill Joff. But he's
kills Tywin, though.
But he kills Tywin. So he kills his mother and father. And then Jaime would
And I don't know if you Cersei. Can really put his... If you can really put Joanna's death on right. him. If anyone, you
but
put it on Mad King...
But he says it sometimes.
Yeah, if anyone, you'd put it on Mad King Ares, but that's...
If you die in childbirth, do we blame the baby?
Yeah.
I don't think so.
No, I don't think so.
But then they would both have strangled the women that they love with hands of gold.
He kills Shay.
With the, what is it called? The necklace or whatever?
Yeah, right.
So the hands of gold are always
hand,
warm.
Was the hand of the king
chain,
pendant? Chain?
Chain.
Yeah.
Hand of the something chain.
Yeah, it was the chain. Yeah.
These are a hell of a drink. You're out, man.
We're out.
I have a mouthful left.
I'm buzzed and I'm
And they both, fuck. The last one, they both saved King's Landing from absolute ruin. Jaime with the wildfire and Tyrion
from
at
the
battle
of the
Blackwater.
Blackwater. Yeah.
He leads the charge out that saves the city.
So does Jaime end up dead and Tyrion ends up riding a dragon? And then that's where the similarities end.
Fucking. So, Jaime. So, what happens in the future? I don't know. Jaime goes off with Brienne, presumably to go meet up with Zombie Cat in the Riverlands.
Yeah.
I have no idea what's going to happen there. So, the Brotherhood Without Borders. Banners.
Doctors Without Borders.
Damn it.
Yep.
Banners. And then the Hound, it's not actually Sandor Clegane. It's Lem Lemoncloak is wearing the
Hound's
helmet.
Right.
And being a maniac.
Yeah,
so,
and if
I have
you
no
listen
idea
to
what
our,
happens there.
If you listen to our Sandor vs. Clegane episode, you'll know that Mr. Clegane is actually on the island.
Yep.
Which, by the way, we may have to come back to this.
Yep.
I think there's going to be a Clegane Bowl.
Everybody, the Clegane Bowl is pretty popular.
It is.
But why?
It makes sense. Well, because they hate each other. And Sir Robert Strong is... Let's save that for another episode.
We could discuss it. There's one more thing. There's always one more thing.
There's always one more thing.
Well, I just want to get to the end of my notes, because I made notes. We should make it to the end of the notes. All right,
let's do it.
Hour and a half. Let's just say we're a two-hour podcast.
We're an hour and 36 minutes.
So the scene is that Cersei is still imprisoned by the Faith, and Sir Kevin comes to visit her.
Okay.
And this is when Cersei gets the information that if she was listening to it, she would maybe... change her idea about the prophecy, but she doesn't. Here it is. Kevin held her at arm's length. Jaime, then? Is it Jaime? No, Jaime is still in the Riverlands somewhere. Somewhere? Cersei did not like the sound of that. He took Raventree and accepted Lord Blackwood's surrender, said her uncle. But on his way back to Riverrun, he left his tail and went off with a woman. A woman? Cersei stared at him, uncomprehending. What woman? Why? Where did they go? No one knows. We've had no further word of him. The woman may have been the Evenstar's daughter, Lady Brienne. Her. The queen remembered the Maid of Tarth. A huge, ugly, shambling thing who dressed in man's mail. Jaime would never abandon me for such a creature. My raven never reached him. Elsewise, he would have come. But Jaime did get that fucking letter, and he ignored it.
He said, fuck you, Cersei. I'm with my new woman now.
Yeah.
He basically ghosted her.
He said, do you want to read this one?
What
it one? Might be too small for you.
What? I can read? What are you talking about?
So that's the thing. This is when Jaime, that's the top there. That's when Jaime gets that letter from Cersei.
Once Raventrill yielded.
Yeah.
His work along the Trident would be done, and he would be free to return to King's Landing. To the king, he told himself. But another part of him whispered, to Cersei. He would have to face her, he supposed. Assuming the High Septon had not put her to death by the time he got back to the city. Come at once, she had written. In the letter, he had pack burn back at Riverrun.
Yeah, he burned her fucking letter. He was like...
Help me! Save me! I need you now as I have ever needed you before.
I love you.
I love you. Come at once.
Come.
Her need was real enough, Jaime did not doubt.
Yep.
As for the rest, nah. She's been fucking Lancel and Osmond Kettleback and Moonboy for all I know. Even if he had gone back, he could not hope to save her. She was guilty of every treason they have laid against her. And he was short a sword hand.
Right? Like, this is Jaime a mere few chapters later being like, bitch, I can't help you.
He's like, even if I came back, I'd have to fight all those fuckers. To be honest, you're fucking guilty.
You're guilty. You're guilty. I can't save you. I don't have a fucking sword hand. Yeah. So Cersei is like, oh, he didn't. Her hubris is getting in the way. He didn't get my letter. He got your letter and he burned it. Because there's nothing. He's moving away from you, girl.
Yeah.
And in the show, they have them nose to nose for some reason. So, okay, show. You got to do what you got to do.
Well, let's see what happens. But we've still got eight more episodes of the season. So.
I find Jaime one of the most compelling characters. I can't wait to see what happens with him and Brienne.
Yeah.
I don't think Zombie Cat kills them. I'll be very interested to see how it plays out.
I'm telling you, I'm calling it now. Trial by combat, Jaime wins.
Yeah.
Jaime becomes a good guy for Lady Stoneheart.
Yeah, maybe. Lady Stoneheart has to have something in mind. I think something's going to hinge on the fact that she had Brienne swear an oath that, what was the Sansa oath that Theon reminds her of or whatever? Pod reminds her.
You will always have meat in my hearth.
That's like the same. That's in the book. It's Catelyn that has Brienne swear that.
Yeah.
But and part of it is like, I will never ask you to do dishonorable. I will never dishonor you by asking you to do something, you know, cruel or unjust.
Yeah.
Something like that.
Something along those lines.
And now here, Catelyn, Zombie Cat, is asking her to do just that at penalty of her own life. So I feel like that's going to have to play a part.
Maybe that's what happens. Maybe Brienne brings Jaime back, and then Brienne goes, you can't kill him. You can't have me kill him.
You swore an oath too, Zombie Cat.
Yeah, exactly.
You swore an oath that you would never ask me to do this. So I don't know, because it'll just be interesting. I don't know what the future holds. Cleganebowl, or there's a vision that Brienne had that maybe includes Jaime. It's a lot of his symbolism of, like, golden. So, like, there's some big battle in Jaime's future, but I don't know what it is. And he's moving away from Cersei. Radio Westeros pointed out, you can have, at first, they're two of the same. They're mirror images of each other. If I was a man, I'd be Jaime. If I was a woman, I'd be Cersei.
Right.
But they point out that yin and yang are also a whole, and they're opposites. Night and day, light and dark, good and evil. And that maybe what George is doing through Jaime's chapters and Cersei's descent to madness is somebody going up to goodness and somebody descending down to madness and evil.
You know, that makes a lot of sense, because they were maybe at an even playing field at one point. And then Jaime gets more and more good, and Cersei gets more and more mad. Yeah. And so they're kind of this still...
They do an inversion thing.
Yeah, they're still kind of a whole person, but they end up... crazy and
opposites. I think so. That's part of, there it is, guys. That's part of why I think Jaime is one of the most fascinating characters in the story, why I love him so much.
And if we want to bring it all back, that's why we started out with Black Russians and ended up with White Russians.
We're down to the dregs of the white. It's hard, man. It's hard being a white knight. Hey, there's what the train is that?
There's the train.
That's a new train. That's a very loud train.
Yeah, it was a very loud train.
Holy crap. Going a little long tonight.
It's a little long. It's all right.
Anyway, guys, Jaime Lannister, Brienne, Mad Queen Cersei. Sometime in the future, we'll do Great North Conspiracy.
Yeah. Hey.
Until then, Dave will have beef jerky.
Ooh, yes. Spicy Penang chili beef jerky that I get at the farmer's market.
Jeez Louise.
Extra spicy, see?
If you want to be authentic, remember to stir extra your spicy. Your stir white your Russian.
White Russian with a stick
extra
of beef.
Extra spicy beef jerky.
Hey, I've seen Bloody Marys with a lot more than beef jerky in them. I can have a white Russian with a little beef jerky in it.
Amen, brother.
Anyway, ladies and gentlemen, thanks for listening to this beautiful episode about Jaime Lannister, about season 6, episode 2, and just about some random shit.
Yeah.
So...
Here's to
you guys sticking with us.
Here's to your redemption. No, resurrection.
Resurrection
erections.
Erection. I hope you all have resurrection erections tonight.
All men
must drink.